Could we be any more excited? Is the ad campaign Crave launched in early 2021 to let Canadians know they could now stream Friends? You heard right, folks. Friends. The American sitcom that aired from 1994 to 2004. Congratulations, Crave, on being a leader in advertising the purchase of foreign content that has been in syndication for 18 years. Could we be any more excited? Was also Chandler's infamous line from Friends. I didn't know this until someone said it. Wow, Crave, you're doing some really fucking forward work over here. HBO Max purchased the exclusive rights to Friends for between $400 and $500 million and outbid Netflix, who paid $100 million for the exclusive streaming rights back in 2015. Now, I was looking for, well, how much did Bell Media, who owns Crave, paid for Friends? But I can't find that information. Now, the reason I have such a beef with all of this is because Crave and its parent company, Bell, are supposed to be making Canadian content. They are a Canadian broadcaster. And yet when you look at their lineups, they're not broadcasting Canadian content because they're not making fucking Canadian content. They're purchasing mostly American content and rolling it out as though they made it. It's really quite crafty. Now, for those of you who don't know, Crave is a subscription-based video on demand service owned by Bell Media, who is owned by the parent company BCE Inc., a Canadian telecommunications company that's been around since 1880. A monolith in the Canadian telecommunications arena. Bell Canada is one of the main assets of BCE Inc., who owns Bell Media, with CTV being one of its properties. Currently, CTV is advertising its latest acquisition, Masked Dancer. I'm sure you've seen the ads all over, okay? But I don't know if you've seen this bag of dicks. Here it is.
Listen up, y'all, cause this is it. The beat that I'm banging is delicious.
At first I thought, what's Sylvester Stallone's mother doing on Masked Dancer? And then I realized it was Paula Abdul. Now look, I know the girl's been through a lot, but I'm just making an observation, okay? Skin's been poked, stretched out, rolled over with a rolling pin. So the Bell Group of Company, as I said, they have this unique approach to advertising acquisitions as though they were their own properties. Sometimes I get so excited when I see an ad on The Gardener for a new CTV show, and then I'm like, oh my God, a new Canadian show. No, it's not. It's just a new purchase. So, Bell, let's talk. Bell, Let's Talk is their corporate philanthropic propaganda campaign to get people talking about their mental health, which I don't want to have anything to do with because I don't want to let a corporation know how I feel. And I mean, you know what, Bell? You got all the phone lines, so you can listen, literally listen in anytime. But this campaign makes it easier for the data mining. You know what I mean? They could just mine the shit out of us. While I know that there are very tangible benefits from this campaign, at least that's what the internet's saying, how about looking into the damage you've caused by making such little content when you were supposed to? Bell development execs are notorious for telling artists when they go and pitch TV ideas, that's a great idea. You should go sell it to the US because it's cheaper for us to buy American content. Not only is this incredibly offensive, but it is such a blatant description of monopoly capitalism. It's cheaper for us to be lazy, not have to think too much, just repackage existing hit shows and rely on American celebrity instead of creating our own. Which is your motherfucking mandate, okay? Doesn't this sound like corruption? I'm saying it's one of the greatest swindles in Canadian history. Now, I know by now you realize motherfucker is a constant expletive I use in my podcast, and I'm not going to stop anytime soon, so get into it. So, okay, how cheap is it to buy American content? So I did some research, and I researched, and I researched, and I couldn't find a fucking thing. I went to the most obvious place, Bell's annual report, but there was literally nothing, and I was like, am I going crazy? And, you know, I'm a researcher by trade, FYI. Not to brag, but, you know, just so you know. I have a master's in history and was a documentary film researcher for a time until I became a comedian full time, which right now is no time. So here I am. So at the time, which was around November 2018, I decided to email my member of parliament, Julie DeBrusen, and her office informed me that expenditures from outside of Canada are not required, so there is no data on it. So basically, the broadcasters do not have to report their purchases of foreign content. How convenient. So I called the CRTC because, okay, I need more information, all right? This is what I do. I called the CRTC, which is the Canadian Radio and Telecommunications, what's the C? Oh my God, commission. So I called the CRTC because I'm like, I don't buy any of this shit. I need the goods from the big guys. The CRTC is the Canadian Radio and Telecommunications Commission. They told me that generally speaking, American TV costs $10 million an hour. Canadian TV costs $1 million an hour. And that is to make it. So Canadian broadcasters say, well, we just can't compete with those economies of scale. Instead, we'll take that million and buy American shows like Seinfeld, Big Bang Theory, Mike and Molly, Masked Dancer, Friends, und so weiter. Just think about all the millions of dollars that our broadcasters spend to purchase ready-made content from our neighbors that they could be granting to our comedy creators. I'll take a poll right now and ask my comedy pals what they would do with $1 million. Oh yeah, I got the results in. They're passing out from the possibilities. It's so flippant to say, go to the United States because it's cheaper for us to buy American content. How do I go to an American broadcaster to sell a Canadian idea? Well, one way is to apply for a U.S. visa or a green card, which costs upwards of $5,000 or $10,000. And then you got to wait a year or two and, you know, hopefully be accepted. It's really a discriminatory system. And now that idea that you had, that TV show concept, is no longer a Canadian story, but an American one. In the end, aren't I supposed to come to you, Canadian broadcaster? I know a comedian who went to Rogers to pitch a TV show, and they said, we don't make any comedy. So what the fuck do you do? And why did you take that meeting? So you ask yourself, I've asked myself, what happens to our stories? They disappear. They discontinue. Now, broadcasters are mandated by the government through the CRTC to make a certain amount of Canadian content. How much, do you ask? Well, the CRTC mandates that broadcasters must make a minimum percentage of programs of national interest. What's that? Programs of national interest, which include programs that belong to categories of long-form documentary and drama and comedy, as well as award shows of national or regional scope that celebrate Canadian creative talent and or cultural diversity and achievements in Canadian arts and culture. Bell and Core services will be subject to P&I expenditure requirements of 7.5% and 8.5% of the previous broadcast year's gross revenues. Rogers P&I expenditure requirements will be maintained at 5% of the previous broadcast year's gross revenues. Between 5 and 8%, that's all they got to make. So based on those percentages, let's just look at what's on the schedule tonight for CTV. If we go to comedy, of course, look. At 7 o'clock, we got Friends. So from 7 to 9, we got Friends. So if you don't have any friends, you got Friends on TV. Then from 9 to 10:30, you got Big Bang Theory. Then Full Frontal with Samantha Bee, who's Canadian, but it's an American show. The Daily Show with Trevor Noah. Conan. If you look at CTV, okay, at 7 o'clock, we got E-Talk, The Big Bang Theory, The Masked Dancer, Holmes Family Effect, For Life, and then news. I mean, what the fuck is The Big Bang Theory? It's both on CTV and on CTV comedy. And guess what? There was no motherfucking Canadian comedy on that CTV comedy channel. Now, for a lot of people, they don't give a shit about Canadian content rules. Their perception for a long time has been Canadian TV sucks, it's bad. Well, certainly there are a lot of examples of bad Canadian TV, but the worst bad TV is making no TV at all. That's your fucking job. If a fridge factory said, you know what, I don't want to make fridges because it's cheaper for me to buy American fridges, then you're not a factory no more. You're just an acquisitions company. Now let's look at another market, just to compare. The United Kingdom. Oh, do we not love their content, right? How much amazing stuff are they making all the time? Well, there's a reason for it, okay? So from 2018, Ofcom, which is the Office of Communications, they require at least 75% of all program hours on BBC's most popular TV channels to be original productions, commissioned by the BBC for UK viewers, reaching 90% during peak evening hours on BBC One and BBC Two. Furthermore, there will be new requirements on Radio 1 and Radio 2 to play a broader range of music than commercial stations, and more music from new and emerging UK artists. The children's channels CBBC and CBeebies, adorable, must respectively show at least 400 and 100 hours of brand new UK commissioned programs each year. Oh boy, Canada's in trouble. Let's just look at the list of programs that the CTV has. Just check it out, okay? Current programming. Comedy, Jan. That's it, Jan. Drama series, Cardinal and Transplant. I love those two series. And Transplant has been, I think it's either back in production or it's just been renewed for season two, thank you. Reality documentary, The Amazing Race Canada, MasterChef Canada, which are just two franchises of American shows, and Mary's Kitchen Crush. And Pop Life, talk shows, Marilyn Dennis, The Social, and then you got the news, okay. Then Canadian content reruns, Carter, Cash Cab, Comedy Now, which Comedy Now is literally so old. You don't know how old it is. I think it's like 20 years old. Corner Guest, Flashpoint, Homes on Homes, Jade Fever, Just for Laughs, Mighty Trains. Now let's look at American series, okay? And you see where they've been aired since, all right? Look at this. $100,000 Pyramid, 911 Lone Star, Academy Awards, All Rise, The Amazing Race, American Housewife, American Music Awards, American Ninja Warrior, Be Positive, Big Bang Theory, reruns, do you see that? Billboard Music Awards, Blue Bloods, The Bold and the Beautiful, Bob Hart's Abishola, Call Me Cat, Catfish the TV Show, Comedy Central Stand Up Presents, Conan, The Conners, Criminal Minds, The Daily Show with Trevor Noah, The Dr. Oz Show, Dr. Phil, Drunk History, Ellen DeGeneres, Ellen's Game of Games, Filthy Rich, Floribama Shore, what the fuck is that? For Life, Golden Globe Awards, Goldbergs, You See on The Late Night Show with James Corden, Late Night with Seth Meyers, Law & Order Special Victims, Live with Killian Ryan, Magnum P.I., Masked Dancer, Masked Singer, Master Chef. Guys, on and on. I could go on and you could hopefully throw up. I don't want you to throw up, but you're just going to throw up from the grotesqueness of all of this. So why mandates and requirements for content? As we see, the BBC or the UK is saying, we require you to make this amount of content. Where did that come from? Well, it's otherwise known as the quota system. And why does any country need to implement quotas? You guessed right, Hollywood. So in the 1930s, there was a major reaction to Hollywood dominance on world screens. So countries like France, the United Kingdom, and Australia implemented quota systems. But guess who didn't? Us, Canada. At the time, according to George Melnick, in 100 years of Canadian cinema, oh, I know, sounds like a yawn, but it is, should be required reading if you're in the biz or if you care about this country at all. Anyways, Melnick says, the state felt it had no interest to protect by bringing in quotas since there was no Indigenous feature film industry in Canada. And using quotas to create opportunity for Indigenous film production was too far-sighted even to be considered, okay? Film historian Peter Morris concluded that Canadian government colluded with Hollywood producers to establish subsidiaries in Canada and thereby circumvent the clear intent of the British quota system. So Hollywood, in a cunning move, bypassed the British quota system by using Canada as a film location and would screen films at midnight in theaters in Britain. So it's been over 100 years that these motherfuckers have been using Canada as a film location. At the turn of the 20th century, the leaders in cinematography were Hollywood and France, and then Hollywood took off. So what was happening in Canada in the film industry? Well, Quebec was making films mythologizing the Roman Catholic Church, and English Canada was making films to get people to move here. So you can see there really was no film industry at the time. And it wasn't until the 1970s that shit started to roll here. It always feels like there's this existential threat to Canadian culture. And I guess it's always been there, you know? And to add insult to injury, all of the broadcasters applied to the CRTC for exemption on their Canadian content requirements due to COVID. They made a submission to be exempted from making between 5 and 8% of Canadian content. Sounds to me like they just don't want to make any Canadian content at all. So, all of this to say, could we be any more excited to be artists in Canada? I think not. I've been Sandra Battaglini. Thank you for being with me for another episode of Small Battalion.